Good morning. Can we just begin with a prayer here? It's a beautiful song. This leads us into a place of worship. Holy Father, we are so grateful to be gathered this morning to hear and to sing songs that celebrate who you are, to draw comfort and support and encouragement from people who, like us, are on this journey trying to find our way. We are grateful that you are a God who not only does not expect us to be perfect, but knew before the creation of the world that we wouldn't be. And thank you. Bless our time together this morning as we worship, as we remember, as we learn, as we connect with you and with each other. Bless us to leave here today more committed than ever to letting you be in control of our lives and for us to be submissive to your will. In Jesus' name we pray. And all that agree say, amen. And you know what you just agreed to was that you're going to be submissive to the Lord this week. So you might want to think about that, all right? That's hard. Hey, if you're a guest this morning, welcome to Twickenham. We are so glad that you are here. Thank you for coming out to be with us today. If you are looking for a church home, we are looking for new family members and would love to talk with you about where the Lord has taken us how you can be a part of that. We do not think we have it all together. In fact, we are convinced that we do not. And so if you're not together either, you'll fit right in. All right? So glad you're here. There's a card on the seat in front of you. You can make a note on that if you'd like. If there's a prayer request that you have, put that down and we'll pray over that. This afternoon, right after this service, it'll actually be still morning time when this service ends in about 65 minutes or so, one of our journey groups, which is the adult groups that get together and try to figure life out together, is going to be having lunch downstairs. If you are a guest this morning, we'd love to have you come downstairs and have lunch with us free of charge. I think we're having Sausalitos. Is that right? Who is it? Sausalitos. Who's the name of that Mexican restaurant over here? Sausarita. Okay, I'm Italian, so I thought maybe it was the other one. I'm going to get the team on up here. You guys come on up, and let's stand, and we're going to begin our time of praise. I know that in every church, things are a little bit weird. If it's not where you're used to going to church, if you're not going to church at all. So we're just glad you're here. Participate wherever you can, and just know that we're honored that you chose to be with us this morning. Let's sing together. Let's praise the Lord.
Hear the holy roar of God resound.
Hear the holy roar of God resound.
Was the waters part before us now?
Was the waters part before us now?
Come see what He has done for us. Tell the world of His great love.
Forever.
to you, Lord, the God of our father Israel, from everlasting to everlasting.
Yours, Lord, is the greatness and the power, and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours.
Yours, Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all.
Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things.
In your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all.
Now, our God, we give you thanks and praise your glorious name.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice.
Good morning, all. And the whole church said. I've been wanting to borrow that from Lincoln for about 4 years now, so bucket list checked. So Thursday, about early afternoon, late afternoon, I received a phone call on my cell phone, and it was a 678 number. So probably like a lot of you, when I see a number that I don't really recognize, I'm kind of hesitant to answer it. So 678 is where my brother, a sister lives there, and I got several friends in the Atlanta area. So I decided to answer it, and it was actually Jody. So Jody was then began to tell me that would I be interested in ministering the communion on Sunday. So I, unlike some of you, if I hear a vessel of God asking me a question, which Jody is our pastor, I'm probably gonna shy away from the no and directly answer that as a yes. So I did say yes. And so he began basically to say that, you know, his sermon was gonna be built around how God is in control of the universe and everything, and he's the King of Kings, Lord of Lords. So I immediately thought that, well, you got the sun, the moon, the stars, mountains, air we breathe. All of these are testaments to God being in control and that he is the creator of the universe. So with me, what was direct first correlation that I could think of from my past was growing up in the Henrietta Street Church of Christ back in Rockford, Illinois on the west side, and then later attending the Kishwaukee Street Church of Christ. I just used to be in awe at how the brothers would administer the communion, and they could just recite verbatim seven scriptures without looking at the Bible, and that referencing was just like something that was so big for me. So when it came time for me to be called upon, I was baptized when I was 10 years old, so I was called to do the communion at about ages 11 or 12. So the year was 1979. I was 11 years old then. So for our youth group over here, I think our version of Facebook would have been a Rolodex. So, and if you don't know what that is, just ask Alexa or Siri. They'll be happy to tell you. But the thing about it was is that I learned that later when I got a little older that it wasn't so much the brothers memorizing these verses and being able to say it verbatim so easily, but that the real message was the fact that at that time, that was the time that we used to reflect back and understand and really take in what it was that Christ did for us and how he died for us, and that this is the time that we have to take the bread and take the cup and remembrance of him at that time. So that was what was later the value to me, and that was how I knew that, you know, God was in control of everything, because we take that time in meditation and that's what we're here for. So with that mindset, what I would like to do at this time is let us take our minds back to the cross as we prepare for the communion. And the Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 26 through 29, "For as often as ye eat of this bread and drink of this cup, ye do shew the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat of this bread and drink of this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body." Back up to the 23rd verse, Paul writes, "For I receive of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus in the same night in which he was betrayed took the bread. He brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." Will you bow with me, please? Heavenly Father, we ask forgiveness for all of our sins. We ask that you bless this bread that we are about to take as a representation of Jesus' body, who died on the cross for the remission of sins for many. May we take it with the proper understanding that is written in the New Testament. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. the 25th verse, Paul states, "After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, 'This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye also, drink it in remembrance of me.'" Will you bow with me, please? Heavenly Father, thank you also for this cup that we are about to receive, which represents Jesus' blood, your Son. May we take it also with the proper understanding as it is written in the New Testament. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
You want to turn in your Bibles to Daniel chapter 4. We're going to be in a bunch of different verses this morning, but Daniel 4 is a place that would be really interesting for you to get to. It's kind of in the middle of the Old Testament, Daniel chapter 4. Hey, I thought it would be a good idea if I gave you just a couple of areas that you can be in prayer about and be involved in. It's always good to know there are opportunities besides what happens here on Sunday mornings. We have a ministry called Jobs for Life. We call it JFL for short, Jobs for Life. And it's a group of our folks get together and they work with people who are struggling to find employment or to find full-time or better employment. And sometimes these folks are coming out of a background that has just quite frankly given them some baggage. And we kind of help coach them on how to do interviews and how to find a job. And we've had some great success stories. And we do all of that from a Christian perspective. We're able to pour into these folks' lives in ways that are not just helping them professionally out in the world, but also in their own hearts. This morning, Ken Smith is one of our shepherds. He'll be leading the closing prayer at the end of our service this morning. He is also the lead shepherd for that ministry. So if you'd like to talk to somebody about that, Ken will be your guy. So the last guy up this morning is the one that can tell you about Jobs for Life. So that's just a good thing for you to know. Second thing, on Mother's Day, we're going to begin a series on the family called Good and Messy. Okay, that sound like your family, maybe? The messy part? All right. We're going to start that series on Mother's Day, and it'll run through Father's Day. And what we're going to be doing is looking at a lot of the families that are in the Bible. And here's what we're going to discover. They were broken. Almost all of them were just a mess, which is really good news because my family, your families are probably messy sometimes. And so the good news is God knows that, and God can use that and bless that. So this would be a great opportunity for you to invite a friend to come and be with us, especially somebody that's going through some family struggles right now. Because here's what we're not going to do. We're not going to beat people up. Okay, we're going to tell the truth about what God wants for families, but we're going to do that as we always try to do at Twickenham from a perspective of grace and mercy. So be really safe, really good series for you to bring a friend to, a neighbor, coworker, friends at school. Good and Messy starts on Mother's Day. And you're probably wondering, what is he holding in his hand? This is a sort of a standard remote control for a television set, probably a lot like what you have at your house, except that this one has some special modifications made to it. Okay, it's been re-engineered for preachers with some church-specific functions and controls. See, not everybody is like Kelvin, who led the Lord's Supper meditation this morning. When the preacher calls, not everybody says yes. So we're beta testing this at Twickenham. Now, here's a cool thing. You know, we have a live feed of our services on Sunday mornings. In fact, right now, there are people who have been providentially hindered from being here, and they are home right now watching us online. Did you know that with this new device, I can actually change the live feed? This is cool. I'm just going to click it here, and we'll just see what happens. This is kind of neat. So, oh, you guys are hilarious. That's Whitesburg Baptist. That's not me. So anyway, we have some issues to deal with here. So this is just the sending unit, okay? This is just the sending unit, and it's no good without the receivers. We actually have those upstairs in the closet, and they're really neat. They're called subcutaneous radio frequency identification chips, and they go under the skin, and they're small as a grain of rice. It won't hurt a bit. We've got some people from the arsenal who will be here next week, and they're going to install them in you. This will be cool. It'll be okay, see? Because if you're not singing loud enough, Lincoln, all we got to do is hit volume. And it goes up. And if somebody interrupts the sermon, mute. It's kind of neat. And if I make a really good point, I can hit rewind. See? And if I make a really good point, I can hit rewind. See? And if I make a really good point, and then there's a laugh button. I can hit laugh. So there's a lot of neat stuff here. There's give more. I like that one. There's repent. Some of you need that. And then my favorite, it just says on time. So I hit this, and next week everybody's on time. Perfect. Okay, it's not real. Do you know a few years ago there was a movie about a guy that actually found a remote, and it could work on live. He could rewind and fast forward and change the channel. Be honest. Be honest about it. Isn't there a little part of you that would love to have that kind of control? I mean, it's why we buy stuff. I buy a new golf club every now and then because it promises to help me control the flight of the ball. So far, they're all liars. This is why we use the calendars on our phones, because they promise to help us control our time. It's why we buy those diet plans and diet pills and gym memberships, because they promise to help us control our weight. The desire for control is why we buy anything. Every new product promises us that it's going to give us more control over our lives. And it's a myth, at least for us, but not for God. We're in a series called High Definition Faith, Faith HD, and what we're trying to do is to really drill down and get clear on what we believe. And we're finishing this sentence right now. God is, and this morning we're going to finish it this way, God is in control. He is, we are not. Now you should know that this particular attribute of God is and has been historically a source of tremendous disagreement among Christians. Okay, there's a group of Christians that lean toward the Reformed position or Calvinism, and then there's a group that sort of leans in a different direction, and they're called Arminian sort of leaning Christians. They see it a different way. And both groups and everybody in between can cite passages that support their conclusions. And I know for a fact that we've got people in both groups in this audience. So it's likely that you're going to hear something you do not agree with. It is a good thing then to remember that our unity is based not on our correct conclusions. It's based on what God did for us through Jesus. Our unity is a gift that the Spirit gives us and that we're supposed to keep. It's not something that we can create out of some kind of debate society. And it's also good to remember that nothing would please the devil more than seeing Christians get sideways with each other by disagreeing over the nature of a God we can barely comprehend. So, that said, let's get into this. The $10 theological term for God's total control is sovereignty. It means the exclusive right and ability to exercise supreme authority. And the definition is kind of right there in the middle of the word, R-E-I-G-N, reign. God reigns. And the Bible talks about this all over the place. The Bible's got a lot to say about this. Proverbs 19, many are the plans in a person's heart, but the Lord's purpose prevails. Or Lamentations 3, who can speak and have it happen if the Lord has not decreed it? James chapter 4, you ought to say, if it's the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. Job 42, I know that you can do all things, no plan of yours, Job says to God, can be thwarted. Psalm 115, our God is in heaven, he does whatever pleases him. And then Proverbs 16:33 even says, the lot is cast in the lap, talking about dice, but it's every decision is from the Lord. So the next time you go to Vegas, or Tunica, or Pearl to play Monopoly or whatever it is you do in those godforsaken places. Remember, the Bible says that God decides how many dots roll up on the dice. Now, we usually think of sovereignty in terms of governments. The United States is a sovereign nation. And that means that our government, not somebody else's, gets to say what happens in our borders. But when we say that God is sovereign, what that means is that God gets to say what happens everywhere. All right, so I mentioned at the beginning to look up Daniel chapter 4. There's a great example of that, of God having that kind of authority and control in Daniel chapter 4. Nebuchadnezzar was king of Babylon, and he had been warned by God that he needed to change his ways, but he didn't. And so God sends him this troubling dream. And none of the king's wise men can interpret the dream, and so Nebuchadnezzar calls for Daniel. By the way, toward the end of the summer, we're going to do a whole series on Daniel for you guys, kind of getting you ready to go back to school. That'll be really cool. So Daniel comes in, and Nebuchadnezzar tells Daniel the dream, and then Daniel gives this interpretation. Listen to this from Daniel chapter 4, beginning in verse 24. This is the interpretation, O king, and this is the decree the Most High has issued against my lord the king. Daniel's talking to a guy that he calls my lord the king. You will be, verse 25, you will be driven away from people and will live with wild animals. You will eat grass like cattle and be drenched with the dew of heaven. Seven times will pass by for you until you acknowledge that the Most High, is sovereign over the kingdoms of men and gives them to anyone he wishes. God is in control. Which probably already is raising some questions. So if God is in control, why does it feel like the world is in such chaos these days? If God is in control, why do bad things happen? I mean, irredeemably bad things. Why do children get cancer? Why are innocent people killed by drunk drivers? Why do hardworking folks lose their jobs? And then this one, if God is in control, why do we even pray? If everything is already set to happen, what difference do prayers make? Those are some really hard questions. And there are plenty more where those come from. And I'll be real honest with you. I will often run out of answers before I run out of questions. Every time I think about this attribute of God. So if you struggle with this a little bit, if this creates some confusion and struggle for you, I'd say that's a pretty normal thing. And that's to be expected. I would also say that I don't think God's put off by that. His ways are so much higher than our ways that there is often going to be a gap between who God is and what we can understand about it. Doesn't mean that we don't try to answer those questions. In fact, in the fall, we're going to do a series called God is Not the Problem. We're going to talk about the problem of evil. Why is there evil in the world if God is all powerful and all good and all loving? So let me just give you three things that I know provisionally, okay? Three things that I think we can say with a certain level of confidence about this idea of God being in control. Here's the first one. God's control does not cancel human responsibility. The Bible really does have a lot to say about how God is in total and complete control of the universe. I mean, that Proverbs passage about God deciding how many dots show up on the dice and who gets to land on Park Place is pretty unambiguous. That tells me God is meticulously involved in what happens on earth. But the Bible has just as much to say about human responsibility and initiative as it does about God taking charge and being in control. In fact, just before it says that God knows who's going to go to Park Place and who's going to go to jail, Solomon wrote, "Better a patient man than a warrior, a man who controls his temper than one who takes a city." So to say that God is in control doesn't mean that you and I don't have any. Scripture, history, our own personal experience tells us that we do, in fact, have an enormous impact on what happens. In fact, this is where we may get into a little area where some of you are going to go, I'm not so sure about that. Scripture even teaches, I think, that we have an impact on God. That what we do has an impact on God. Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 7 is an interesting verse. Israel started worshiping idols and adopting the pagan practices of its neighbors, and God warned them. And despite the fact that they knew how God meant business, when his prophets came and said, you better change your ways, they didn't change your ways. And so this is what God says, what Jeremiah says in Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 7. God said, I thought that after she had done all this, after Israel had done all this, she would return to me, but she did not. This is what God said. I thought she would return, but she didn't. So in 722, God sent the Assyrians to conquer them, which sort of reminds you of what Daniel told the king of Babylon, the Most High sovereign over the kingdoms of men, and gives them to anyone he wishes. The thing I want you to see here, though, is that God said, I thought. God expected, apparently, a different outcome. In Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 30, he says, in vain I punished your people. They did not respond to correction. In Jeremiah 3:19, he said, I thought you would call me father and not turn away from following me. So there's this idea in Scripture that while God is sovereign and in control and the Lord of lords and King of kings, that human beings have this enormous amount of freedom. There's a really sad moment in the ministry of Jesus, even in Matthew chapter 23, where Jesus says, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who killed the prophets and stoned those sent to you, how often I long to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were not willing. I wanted one outcome. You did not want the same outcome. So while Scripture teaches that God is in control, it also teaches that he's given human beings power to make meaningful choices. Moses told Israel, I set before you life and death. Choose. Joshua told Israel, choose this day whom you will serve. Jesus looked out at a mass of people and said, if anyone comes to me, will come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Biggest word in the world is the word if. It means we have choice. It means we have some power. So if you and I have the power to choose good or evil, right or wrong, then God, in his sovereign will, has given us some degree of freedom. So when we say that God is in control, that doesn't mean that you and I don't have any. Let me give you an example of this. Maybe it'll help here. Whenever I give somebody a lift to, I drive and I give somebody a lift somewhere, my favorite thing to do, I always love to do this, is to tell the passenger, you are the climate control officer on this trip. You get to control the temperature. If you're hot, here are the buttons. Just make it cooler. If you're cold, make it warmer. I want my passenger to be comfortable. But I'm still behind the wheel, okay? I think that's sort of how it is with us and God, all right? We have some control, but God's still behind the wheel. Now, here's the second thing that I think can help us understand this attribute of God. And again, I'm holding these things provisionally, okay? I'm trying not to be the authority. I want us to wrestle with these ideas together. The second one is this. God's sovereignty is not just a click away, like it was, you know, when I was playing with you with this thing right here. God's sovereignty is not just a click away. And the first person I ever read talk about this was a guy named Brian McLaren in a book, A New Kind of Christian. It's got some age on it now, but he was the first person that I'd ever read that helped me think about it this way. He writes, we cannot consider the word control without thinking of it mechanistically. In other words, for you, to be in control means to make something happen your way, the way an operator operates a machine, flipping switches, turning gears, pressing buttons. I mean, that's what we call this thing, right? A remote control. I press buttons and things happen. When I drive, I control the direction of my car by turning the wheel. I control the speed with the gas pedal. I control the distance with the brake pedal. Or think about your phone, your tablet, your desktop. You point and click and things on your screen change. If they don't, you reboot or you call IT. And then they tell you to unplug everything and then plug it back up and you go, I already did that. We command instant results with wheels and buttons and pedals and keys and mice and even a simple touch, and it all happens instantaneously, electronically, unambiguously, absolutely. And so when we think about control and we think about God being in control, we get this picture of God sitting up there on his throne with a gigantic universal remote in his hands or a magnificent holographic display, and he's just pointing and clicking away like mad as he runs the universe. When the ancients were talking about the control of God, that's not how they thought about control. They didn't have the kind of technologies we have. To them, control was more dynamic, more fluid, more about the big picture than the pixels. A farmer might control the direction of his ox with reins, but the ox could resist. A parent might control the behavior of a child, but the child could rebel. A king might control the lives of his subjects, but the subjects could revolt. You see the difference between those two concepts of control? When we think of control, we don't include the free will factor. The light bulb doesn't have a mind of its own. It does what it's told, or we put in a new bulb. But God has to work with you people. God has to work with me. And like our computers, people are susceptible to a virus. Ours is called sin, and it makes us resist God's control. That doesn't mean that God lacks the power to just press a button and change the channel. He does. He can do that. What I want you to see is that when we talk about God's sovereignty, we're not talking about something that's just a click away. There's a third way we can think about God's sovereignty. Being a human is like being on a cruise ship. There are all kinds of things to do, all kinds of food to eat, all kinds of shipmates. We have an embarrassing array of choices. We can lay on the deck, we can swim in the pool, we can gamble in the casino. Kind of a theme this morning, isn't it? We can take in all the shows, we can read books, we can sleep, we can even jump ship if we want. But on this cruise, God has determined our ports of call. He's determined where the ship is going to stop. And most important, he determines the destination to which we sail. So here's the last thing I would hold provisionally on this. God's sovereignty means, and actually I don't hold this provisionally, I hold this firmly. God's sovereignty means that his purposes will be achieved, no matter what. Ephesians 1:11 says that God works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will. That does not mean that everything that happens on earth or in your life or mine is precisely in every instance exactly what God wants to happen. It means that in the end, God's purposes, what God wants and intends, will be realized no matter what. This is going to end the way he wants it to, which could be absolutely terrifying. I mean, we've seen what happens when sheiks and sultans and kings in other parts of the world possess unlimited authority even in their limited realms. We even fear what might happen in our own country if a president has power that is unchecked by the other two branches of government. So to talk about a being who possesses universal sovereignty, one who overrules every other authority, one who overrides every other decision and overturns every other power, that could be terrifying. Until we remember how this sovereign God lived among us. He did live among us. He came as a child, and he welcomed children. He befriended sinners. He touched the leper, and he fed the hungry. He healed the sick. He comforted the grieving. He raised the dead, and then he died the death we deserved. And as we will celebrate in a couple of weeks at Easter, he lives again, all because he loved us. There is an iconic image of John F. Kennedy working at the Resolute desk when he was president of the United States. In the foreground, John Jr. is seen peering through the secret door of what John Jr. called my house. To everybody else, the presidential desk was a symbol of power and authority and dominion. But to John Jr., it was a place to play. That's because of the relationship that he had with his father, the man who sat behind the desk. He wasn't just the president. He was his dad. And that's how it is with us and with God. God isn't just the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and the God of Gods. He is not just sovereign over all. He is your merciful Father. He loves you. And because of that, you don't have to be afraid of his sovereignty. In fact, because of his sovereignty, you don't have to be afraid. Let's pray together. Lord, we love you, and we're confident. We know that we often get it wrong about you, and so we ask you to forgive us when we don't think rightly about who you are. But then we're not afraid of being wrong, because you have shown us in a million ways that you are a God of mercy and grace and forgiveness. It is good to know that we can be sons and daughters of a merciful Father. It is good to know that you are sovereign over all, that we do not have to be afraid of you, that we don't have to be afraid of anything. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, let's stand. Let's sing together.
Merciful God and Father, loving us like no other, hear our prayer, the cry of our hearts as we come to you. We acknowledge our transgressions, we confess to you our sins. Show us mercy and compassion. Touch our lives with your healing grace again. Release us from the past as we seek your face. Wash us free. Merciful God and Father,
Did I hear you, Kelvin? Hey, thanks for being here this morning. It's been a great morning. I hope you've been blessed, but more importantly, I believe that God has been blessed, and that's what we're really here for. So thanks for being here. A couple of things as we close. 39ers, don't forget, you have a trip coming up that requires advanced planning. So if you're interested in that trip, make sure that you let folks know that you are signed up and ready to go. Next Sunday, again, bittersweet time together next Sunday afternoon as we have a farewell reception for Shelby and Jesse. It'll be their last Sunday with us. That'll be from 1:30 to 3. It'll be downstairs in the fellowship hall. So come back and wish them well as they take their new ministry position. Teens, you are going to Beauty and the Beast today at Grissom High School. If you're not going to use your ticket, which, shameless plug, is fantastic. You really should consider going. Sorry. If you're not going to use your ticket, you need to let them know so that they can give that away or do something else with it. So again, that's today, and then you have dinner tonight. That's it for today. Thanks for being here. Have a great day and a great week, and let's close in prayer.
Let's pray together. Father, we do acknowledge that you reign above all the chaos of this world, and we take comfort in that, Father. We thank you for your grace and mercy and love. We thank you, Father, for this church, for opportunities to serve, and for ministries to assist other people. We pray, Father, for every individual and every family here. We pray your blessings on them, for especially those who are sick and suffering in any way. We pray for those who are mourning losses and in the grieving process for many different reasons. We ask you to comfort them and to walk beside them. We pray, Father, for parents that are concerned about their children, and we pray for children that are concerned about their parents and caregiving for them. We pray for all the caregivers in the audience. We pray that we can support them and encourage them. We thank you, Father, for the leaders of this church, for the staff here and the passion that they have for the gospel. We pray for our missionaries in Ecuador. We ask you to watch out for them and to be with them. We pray, Father, especially for Shelby and Jesse as they transition to a new ministry. We ask you to be with them in that and help them in every way. We pray that you will send someone here that will be effective in working with our youth and an important part of the family here as we endeavor to do your will. We pray these things in your son's name. Amen.